So it's funny, I haven't seen David in probably 10 years, but back in 2002 or 3 or something like that, I met him at what eventually became known, at least in this part of Mass Ave, as the Cambridge Public Internet Project. And we had, so there was the core researchers, probably 6 or so, in the parallel distributed operating system department of CSAIL that were doing the RoofNet project. And then there were some of us other hanger-oners that were very interested in some subcomponent of it. And the network stack was the really interesting bit, the wireless stuff that, go back to Tim Shepard's paper there. So he wrote this, found a bunch of ways to exploit some very interesting parts, some subband parts of 802.11b. And so you guys probably remember those days. It was 802.11b for years. So you had to just deal with 2.4 and there was all sorts of people bumping into each other and stuff in that spectrum back then. Anyway, make a long story longer.
Just remember 1200 baud modems.
Oh yeah. And they were like the same price as 300 baud modems, but people kept saying, "Oh, my 300 baud modems are error correcting." So you get a true 300 out of these. So the participants we all agreed on something of the same foundation. So you had a stack that had a bunch of interesting little, it had ETH 0, it had Wi-Fi 0, and it had a couple of these VAPs or virtual access points or virtual LANs. And so you create a bunch that you do all your RoofNet talking, like your RoofNet nodes know about other RoofNet nodes, but it doesn't beacon that SSID. So these guys are always constantly doing like power sensing and dialing up, because you can do that at the command line. You can set power up to a watt EIRP on FCC class B devices, and people were doing that, and they were scripting it. And so RoofNet kind of grew out of the fact that you'd throw a bunch of these things out there in people's windows, and they'd talk to each other and dial their power back, and so that they weren't interfering with their neighbors. It was very much machine to machine neighborhood friendly stuff. And so some of the other groups that we bumped into, David's group, Harvard had Harvard had the CitySense.net initiative. So City of Cambridge, like most Massachusetts communities, own their own power, own their own street lamps and what have you. So the Harvard guys could get up at the top of the street lamp. There's power going to it all day, not just night, and hanging their sensor devices off there. And this was part of a big DOE study. They wanted to be able to track the propagation of noxious gases across the city. Now, of course, they were just doing like SO2 or something that was natural to Cambridge, but it was a good field test, years ahead of anybody talking about the Internet of Things. I thought that was very cool. And so they had the same infrastructure we did. It was eventually what worked out to be open mesh. They had the Harvard packets would carry, or the Harvard nodes would carry the MIT people walking around with MIT RoofNet SSIDs. That worked out good for years. JJ Plus made open mesh compatible boxes. They were a local company. Meraki was started by the two guys who were the lead coders up at the MIT RoofNet project. I'm really going to tear through this, because first of all, a lot of these slides are duplicates of one of the other. We were going to call this RoofNet Citywide LAN 4, but then we decided to call it Doobie Brothers, so because we're running out of ways to differentiate. All right, maybe we'll get to this. There you go. Openmesh.com. You can ask. So Steve had a lot more interaction with openmesh.com than I did. This was an outfit in Portland, Oregon. They communicated quite a bit with the RoofNet developers. Had much of the original ideas on how to operate, set up 4 or 5 different Wi-Fi access points and have some of them beacon. So some of them would be client access. They'd be managed mode. And then some of them would be ad hoc mode, and you wouldn't see those. Those were so the nodes could talk to each other. Wibro, I have a picture, which I'm not going to get to. There used to be a tower stream antenna on the top of the John Hancock building, remember the tower stream? So they offered WiMAX and Wibro, which was like a South Korean version of WiMAX. So we had, we put a bunch of these freewalkers.com nodes, which are also RoofNet. Everything was even open mesh RoofNet based node, and then we bridged it to the tower stream antenna. And another company we had, I did that company with Ash Dyer, the CIO wireless of City of Cambridge. So all these RoofNet. So at the high water mark, there were probably, certainly in the City of Cambridge, 150 RoofNet nodes with people sticking them in windows. The City of Cambridge gave nodes out to people in the Washington Elm and the Newtown Court housing project, and they give them to you and have a big sticky on the back, stick them in the window, and they had arranged all the gateways so that you would get a signal, and then you could either talk to it with your laptop or you could put Ethernet into it, and it would talk to the to one of the RoofNet nodes that was hanging off of some lamppost, being powered off of the top. You know, the City of Cambridge would send an installer up there to stick an access point, and then that in turn would talk probably to City Hall, because we had a couple of straight lines of sight from Newtown Court to Town Hall. This is the tower stream. That's not the exact picture from the Boston Globe, but the tower stream antenna got hit by lightning that weekend, and we were a single point of failure out of bridging that year. Yeah, so this is a good example of what kind of coverage we had just on the MIT RoofNet nodes. You didn't need a password. I mean, it was just the SSID was RoofNet, but it wasn't Cambridge Public Internet. We didn't have citywide coverage. We had communities that you could then transition. We each access point, I think, had 255 addresses, and you could just walk around. You'd have 10.something.something.124. And so if you walked over to Cambridge port, your IP address would still be routable because we were all NATed back in this huge Class A NAT up at City Hall. So it wasn't a bad idea. I mean, TCP is a very, very tolerant protocol. You can walk around and get into a, go transit to a different SSID and a different subnet and still have be able to read your newspaper where you left off. So that's a typical routing page. When you'd open your RoofNet node up, if it was in your window, you could just go and see if you were talking to 15 other RoofNet nodes, you'd see the link status, and you'd be able to find out where your latencies are and how many RoofNet nodes you were going through before you actually fell back in a sink. The RoofNet guys call them sinks, but they're bridges. So that worked out pretty well. And the City Sense project had a very similar routing table. Yeah, so I can give you guys all this at the end. We had a lot of influences. A lot of the guys from the Berlin RoofNet or the SARWiki stuff, they came. Some of them went to school at Harvard, right? Like Aaron.
Captain?
Yeah. He went to Harvard for a year, right? And he helped out on the open air Fenway, open air Boston project. Yeah. All right, I have a picture of, so this was, we tried doing a map. You used to be able to drive up and down Memorial Drive and do a ward drive and get signal strength, and it didn't work too well. We tried mapping out all the hotspots with signal strengths, and it was supposed to be a dynamic. This was one of the RoofNet coverage area, all of those red places was where people walked around and to see if they were getting a strong RoofNet signal. So that was one of the neighborhoods. Tent City was the one that Steve ran, and that RoofNet worked with them to try to get coverage. It was, since it was 802.11, you had to walk around quite a bit, and there were dead zones, and we called it omniscient spoken hub, but agnostic web. So we'd give these nodes out, people would stick them wherever the hell they wanted them, where they needed signal, and then if they weren't getting signal, then we'd intervene, roll the truck, and put a proper access point for them. And so they probably had a better experience with this over at Tent City because a lot of the nodes were outdoors. but at New Town Court, we did a lot of alleys and corners and, you know, putting access points over in the top of the staircase so that we had a straight line of sight downstairs. So 915 megahertz might fix those problems for us. So I have a bunch of pictures if Ryan DeLacy shows up. We did a, during the regatta, we did a solar wireless mile project with a bunch of solar panels, and we had this cool truck inner tube tire thing that had, it was closed off, so you got a partial vacuum, and we create this little bowl, so that was where we would get our parabola shell to get, we had a little piece of PV to get the electricity out of it. There's some of the big solar panels. We blew up a weather balloon, and we wrote the SSID for Cambridge Public Internet on it, and we ran it up, and so there were thousands of people going, hey, free wireless. So we tracked that for a little while, and we were like right across the river. If you were on the bank of the Charles River, you had to pay DPW or whoever runs that, quite a bit of money to have a booth. And so Sprint was renting these dongles for like, $500, and we were given signal away for free. Then we had a big 12 dB antenna hanging off of that down to an access point, and then somebody just close to the river had a Cambridge Public Internet node. So we just bridged it, and real good proof of concept. And if Brian's here, he also did a couple of other projects like this, that the Smoot Outpost project that I think he got arrested at because he parked on the Mass Ave Bridge. And run out of time, but what I'll do is we're going to introduce this guy from Here Lab. He'll also talk about, he's got some products for sale. They're doing a lot of LoRaWAN and Internet of Things installs on Martha's Vineyard. I don't know if you know this guy. But he said he'd talk to us for a half an hour by Google Hangout, and then David will talk to you, and then we might have there might be a guy named Ivan come and talk about MQTT tonight if our timing is good. Let me cue that up. So I told them we're only going to be 10 people here, so I'll point this.
So this is the best we're going to get. My Ripper's here, though.
have slides?
I do.
You do? Because we could, instead of me wasting everybody's time, I can just waste my time over my seat. I'll give him one more minute. Maybe he's on island time. I'll show you the, so this is what, I haven't shown Doobie this yet, but this is, so we have, Steve and I have been doing a lot with just a garden variety Linux dev machine. In our case, we've got a lot of these Jetson TK1s. So I said, okay, cool. So a lot of these radios are mini PCIe, and that's what we got on these boards. So I bought some of the Multitech 950 megahertz LoRaWAN radios. I tried using them with the mini PCIe slot in this. Now, I don't have the driver for this yet, but that's okay, because I use the Miraconta how-to, which I can show you that page. There's this guy, and he's in Brazil, named Nestor. He wrote a really good how-to on how to buy the Multitech radio. It's got a nice SMA connector. You stick the antenna on it. You have to take off a little bit of hardware for it to fit in your USB dongle, but boy, the how-to. I'll show you the how-to page. It's a four-page how-to. You do a little bit of patching of the LoRaWAN gateway, and it just worked flawlessly, right? So we had two of these guys, because I had a bunch of these and a bunch of these, and then so I found a guy who's got a site called 1WRT, and he's using those with a very similar LoRaWAN setup. So I went to WRT node, bought them. They're $20. So you can. Now I bought it because it also has a mini PCIe slot, but I think what we'll do either tonight or soon is get what I got going on with the Multitech Jetson combo on this. It's just that I'm logged into this on that OpenWRT screen. You have to patch the daylights out of it and recompile the OpenWRT kernel, so hopefully there's some Linux experts in here tonight that can show me how to do that. I've got the patches, and I got some instructions on how to do the diff, and they goof around with that. This is a much better way to go, I think, already, to have OpenWRT plus LoRa Gateway rather than any other dev board. I know this thing's going to be easier to, if I stick it outside, it'll be easier to protect. I've got a bunch of, old NEMA 2 approved rubber boxes that are going to be appropriate. So I'll test it out with this combo. And if that works, I'll buy a bunch more of the dongles. The USB to mini PCIe dongles are cheap. They're less than $20.
Well, if you say it's got a mini PCI on board, then that's...
Well, so...
I bet they're just using USB pins that are on mini PCI.
Well, on this guy, well, maybe. So there's two, you can download... From Nestor's site, you can download the SPI version of the gateway or the USB version of the gateway, which is deprecated because they're getting rid of the FTDI support. And I'm trying to follow all of the pull requests, and it looks like I'm going to have to figure out a way to get an SPI connection going pretty soon if I want to stay at the stable version. But I thought it was kind of funny. I've got a couple other cards that I've stuck in here. And it doesn't recognize those either. This is a stock we're going to install on this 1404 or something. So I'm not quite sure what the deal is, but
if you run LSPCI, do you at least get something back?
No.
Is that acknowledged?
No. So maybe it's like a kernel issue rather than
that's what I would.
All right, so let's see what. So he should be showing up here if he's on, right? Sure, that sound means paging me now?
Yeah.
Okay.
You just put the camera.
town.
If you just click the camera button in the top left part of the window, it'll just call on the panels on the sub window you're in.
The sub window is here?
Yeah.
Yeah, and then click on what?
No, no, no. So upper, over his name,
under his name.
There's like a camera.
Oh, under his name, right here?
Yeah.
And then click
just lower? No.
Oh. And then what?
Back to the left slightly of where you were.
This guy here?
Yep. No, just a little bit lower.
Oh, right there. There you go. All right. Try to bring that up.
Great. No worries. All right. Well, thanks everybody for inviting us. I'm with HereLab, which is intended to be a public good enablement initiative for place-focused, community-driven Internet of Things on Martha's Vineyard and what we've called a Smart Island Project. And so the big question is, why are we doing this? What's the purpose? And we're trying to enable community-oriented public good IoT. So, number one, Martha's Vineyard is an intimate place and a pretty tight-knit social community and with a lot of real interesting diversity given its size. So we see it as a living laboratory to facilitate using IoT for natural built space and in social contexts. And enabling people here to connect with and understand our world for good, for profit, sustainability, social impact. We really believe that you can only specifically manage what you can measure. And if we enable our community here with the tools of IoT and the technical skills related to that, we can get all the benefits of measuring and actuating in our environment, but also build skills among our population. The next slide, sort of the big why, if you guys are flipping through the slides, is we love to develop a cycle of education to export, sort of this learn, intern, earn, export model. And one of the reasons is Martha's Vineyard, a lot of people know it from its tourism industry, but if you actually look at the year-round population, it has some of the lowest average incomes in Massachusetts. And so we see the future. We're raising our family here, and we'd like our children to be able to thrive and their friends to be able to thrive, leveraging some of the types of skills and capacities that these technologies enable. And so we're not only building out a network on the island, but we're working with teachers and students and leaders in the towns and entrepreneurs and trying to build pathways where kids and adults can learn the skills associated with these technologies and through open source and open access tools and figure out entrepreneurial and other value propositions that these tools enable. One of the things that you may be noticing about this presentation is it's maybe a little less technical. Part of that is we've really led with doing things in the community, educating people, enabling people, giving them examples of getting stuff done that leverage these tools with a view that through that, we're going to test out and prove out the technologies as well as build capacity in our community. So quickly on who, I co-founded HereLab with someone named Patrick Phillips. My background is as an entrepreneur, helping to grow and run private and public companies in the information technology and clean tech space. Patrick has a background in the nonprofit and publishing space. He founded, launched, ran, and then eventually sold a magazine called Arts and Ideas, has a lot of consulting and design and marketing and communications, and especially in the nonprofit space. So we've partnered together. We've partnered with a bunch of people from engineering partners, data, marine biology, systems architecture that have sort of generously led time with us. And we've in our community partnered in the education space, people in the science and aqua farming space. We have partnered.
One of the first things I realized was that we had a traditional advocacy strategy.
I've also had a lot of conversations with some of the bigger companies in the Boston to New York tech corridor. So again, leading with people, in order to enable the people to do things, to do jobs in the community, we have started to build out a network. We've got 6 LoRa gateways that we're in possession of. 5 of them are up and running on Martha's Vineyard. 1 is running in North Falmouth at an aqua farm there as part of a partnership we have. It's all multi-tech conduit gateways and multi-tech M.dot radios by and large. We essentially have taken a AEP local quote-unquote private network campus approach as we build things out, and we're essentially, our view is, let's go do jobs, make our administration a little more easy. We're running Node-RED on the local boxes for provisioning and for the jobs of the different sensors. And our view is we're developing the server architecture strategy as we go through these community and education-centered tests that we're doing. And so our the more populated parts of the vineyard first. And so Vineyard Haven, we have partnerships that I'll go over quickly with the town of Vineyard Haven, working with some selectmen there to do some pilots. We've worked in West Tisbury with schools. So one of the key things of jumpstarting this education to export kind of island capacity is we went to a school where my children happened to go, and we hosted a set of classes over several weeks where the kids built out from bare metal sensors all the way through programming M.dot radios, setting up the Node-RED for 2 jobs, essentially. The school they go to, the pipes freeze essentially every winter because of the design of the school, and so the students were being made part of the solution, building radio-enabled sensors that will send emails to the building administration when the temperature goes too low in the winter or too high in the server room in the summer if power fails. So similarly, our local high school has a lot of building updating issues. The building was built several decades ago and is starting to see the wear of time. And so the physical science and computer science teachers at the Martha's Vineyard Regional High School partnered with us, and they went to the building administration, had their students interview various people for different sensory jobs that we could do to help inform building use projects. And we ran a series of classes where the students in the computer science group learned how to program and code and design these sensors and radio code enablements. And then they work with people in a physical sciences class to implement and run experiments and generate data from them. So we presented that recently at the Martha's Vineyard Maker Fair, and out of that came some interesting temperature and range finding and sound decibel for a library type of sensor usage with all the data pumped up to open sensors for later access via JSON queries and pumped into analytics section. About 3 more slides here and then we can take any questions. We're working with, as I mentioned, an aqua farmer in North Falmouth he's using our technology on dissolved oxygen and some other probes, and he's already made purchasing decisions. So he called up, for instance, just the practical use of these technologies. He called up his supplier and said he wanted to buy 500,000 seats for the wind farm. And the supplier said, well, no one's putting in yet, the water's cool. I know exactly how warm the water is in my part of where my life is. He was able to get an advantage. So you see some really interesting, it's an optical sensor, and a much more cost-effective deployment than some of other sensors that are deployed in sort of marine environments, to hopefully get not only actionable data for him, but correlative data on a number of data parameters that are important to him. As I mentioned, we've got a partnership that we're piloting with the town of Vineyard Haven, working with the selectmen. They're starting with trash and traffic and some water quality. We've been listed for an EPA grant that the town and the Martha's Vineyard Commission have applied for to help supplement some of their more academic science-oriented data with some real-time data. One of the things we're hearing a lot, well, there's a lot of studies done on Martha's Vineyard through the various nonprofits here and in shellfish and in estuaries projects, et cetera. A lot of this data eventually gets buried in a file drawer somewhere. And a lot of it is generated with the data loggers that can take months to get access to, and then sometimes years, if ever, to get access to other stakeholders. So people are pretty excited about public real-time data as a supplement and a complement to other data gathered in some of these projects. And then finally, there's some artistic bents of some of this. We're working outside of our community in Minnesota, where we have Multitech as a partner. There's some people doing interesting IoT artistic and cultural projects on the Mississippi River that we're helping to facilitate as well. So we've gotten a lot of points on the board in 5 months. And again, we're sort of taking a very people-focused, job-focused, how do we serve our community, get people with capacity and understanding of the power of these technologies, with a view that we'll build out the networks over time with more robust capacities, with the more people who have interest in the technologies and the capabilities we've built. So thanks for your time and attention. Happy to take any questions about what we've been up to.
Thank you.
We may email you later, Derek, because we're kind of tight on time, but we'll have some questions for you.
Great.
Thank you.
Well, thanks very much, and sorry I wasn't able to be there in person, but hopefully we'll get up to one of your next meetups.
Thanks a lot.
Thanks for organizing. Cheers.
Thank you. All right, well, so the technical difficulty was I have no idea what my Gmail password is. So if I don't have this, I can't forward slides. So we'll forward you the slides, but meanwhile, we'll cue Dave.
You don't want to show them? Okay.
No, we can do it, because it's going to take David a little while to set up. And you're VGA only?
Yeah.
Okay. But more importantly, is there a place that these guys can download it? Is there a... we put them on a BLU FTP server or something?
Is that a Skype connection?
Yeah, we'll put it there later probably.
Okay. Well, why don't we do that? Because
I can't put it there on BLU, send it to me. That's the bottom line.
Oh, I'll send it to you. No big deal.
Okay, let's get David up here. Are you VGA or HDMI or Thundercloud? Even audio.
Hey, how do you like that?
Alright, so it'll come up shortly.
Okay. Everybody seen that news story in the last couple days about the in-ear device that's going to be able to do simultaneous translation. I was sort of thinking I'd like to have one of those tonight because I am as right-brained and intuitive as you guys are left-brained and analytical. So we're going to see if we can communicate on all this.
So we may have to do some because this is a conversion. Is this an option for you or no?
Yeah, I think that's the same as mine, actually.
Yeah. The VGA connector is kind of the same.
I don't know.
Hey,
yay, there we go. Okay, so at any rate. By way of introduction, I'm David Stevenson from Stevenson Strategies in Medfield. I also am the founder and co-director of the Greater Boston IoT Meetup, which now totals more than 2,000 members. And you are all cordially invited to join us. We meet sometimes twice a month. We're really becoming very active, and we've been increasingly identified with all the privacy and security issues that are involved with the IoT. But also, I am an IoT strategist, and I write what the nice folks at Google tell me is the leading non-corporate blog on the IoT in the world. My website, Stevenson Strategies. And about a year ago, actually, I think it was early July, I heard about these guys in Amsterdam who were creating something called the Things Network. There were 10 of them, 10 of them. Look at them. We got more in this room. And in this, I'm actually trying, in addition to my love of technology, I also love history, so tonight what I'm going to do is to also dredge up a little bit of New England history, and I'm going to try to motivate everybody in the room by one of the wonderful techniques of the Puritans, which was, you can still see these every so often if you drive through some towns on their commons, the stocks, where people were put in stocks and humiliated for things. So what I'm trying to do is to say, what the hell is happening if Martha's Vineyard, of all places, can get LoRaWAN network in a matter of months, and we have been trying for over a year, if you can imagine. One of the things, I quite literally am looking for some people in high places. Because if you can get one of the gateways up on one of the high buildings, like Prue, the new millennial tower apartment on Washington Street, places like that, they have a potential range of 7.5 miles, potential range. Of course, it depends on obstacles and all sorts of things like that. But at any rate, these guys in Amsterdam, with no government approval, no funding, no resources basically, in the space of 6 weeks, pulled off, hold on a sec, this city free, that's critically important, free, citywide data network in 6 weeks, using only 10 gateways. They are now taking the movement global. At South by Southwest in March, they announced that they now have more than 100 cities worldwide that are participating in this movement. And last fall, after they got started, they also ran, these units cost $1,200, and they ran a Kickstarter campaign that, you know, went blew right by their targets in a matter of days to build $200 gateways to reduce the cost. And their goal is to cover the world with these free IoT data networks, okay? So, why is this needed? As apps and sensors proliferate, we need to connect devices in cities to the internet without the high cost of Wi-Fi or 3 or 4G and heavy battery drain on sensors. And LoRaWAN is great in terms of that. And one of the things it does is, and they've seen this in Amsterdam in the years since they have gotten started, it transforms the whole city into
shut down the order for you.
Imagine the audio working now. I've been trying to get that thing to work. But.
And if you're as tired of losing as I am, well.
Sorry about that.
Transforms the whole city into an IoT lab that's open to everyone. And we have been through the IoT meetup trying for a year to get this off the ground. We have had our friends at MathWorks have bought a couple of gateways. They've got one in Natick, and they're going to put one somewhere in the city. We have been, like I mentioned the Millennial Tower, a friend of mine is the developer of the damn place, and I haven't been able to even convince him to allow us to do it. Now, they're so profit-oriented with anything where there's any kind of transmission equipment on their buildings that they can't quite grasp the idea of actually doing something like this in the public interest. So, and we had originally thought we were going to try to limit this because we, again, in our naivete, we thought it was going to be so simple to do it, to Boston and then add Cambridge later, because we figured that was going to be a piece of cake after we got started in Boston. But now, since we have failed utterly so far, we're quite open to changing gears at this point and looking to Cambridge for leadership on this. And it's funny because it does sort of go back to the stuff that Kurt and I were working on 10 years ago. In fact, actually, I have to interrupt myself. One of the most fascinating mesh networks that I know of nowadays, you will not believe this, but it is, I think there are enough of these along Tremont Street that they actually do have a mesh network. The Big Belly trash containers. They, you know, they started out, pardon me for a little bit, but I'm writing a book about IoT strategy right now, and I actually start off with these Big Bellies on the theory that if you can transform as something as humble and usually as disgusting as a municipal trash can into something as elegant as the Big Bellies, you can do just about anything. So at any rate, they started, you know, with the units with the PV compactors that can compact the volume of trash five times, and then the companion units for recyclables. And if they had stopped right there, that would have been really really fantastic. But they were visionary enough. Incidentally, they're headquartered in Needham. And they decided to go beyond that. And so they, I can't remember exactly what units they're including in these. But now they realized that it would be even more valuable if they could communicate the status of the individual units with the DPW so that they would no longer have to base the pickups on historical data, but that can actually be determined on a real-time basis based on which ones actually right now needed to be picked up. And then, just the icing on the cake, they made it into a mesh network as well that, say for example, in a disaster, could actually become a viable communications network. So, just absolutely love it. So anyway, that's sort of the idea behind this. And as I said, they now have more than 100 cities involved and the Kickstarter. And I am having real problems with my, oh, there we go. Okay, so now, more than 100 cities across the world. And they are really, the people in Amsterdam have stuck with this. They didn't just stop with their own thing. And so they are, as I mentioned, they're developing this $200 gateway. They're also working on the network and software equipment firmware that's needed to mess. And you can actually also, no matter where you are in the world, you can use their data network rather than having to do that on your own. Boy, man, having some real problems tonight. Wow. Okay, so benefits of it. And this is part of this idea of, in essence, turning the whole city into an IoT laboratory. That in Amsterdam, one of the things they found is, you know, that obviously they've got a tremendous number of boats, including a lot of pleasure boats that are in the moored in the canals, and frequently those canal boats will sink because they fill up with water and storms and things like that. So they created a very low power transmitter, that sensor that goes in the hull of the boats and alerts authorities when, via the thing's network, when one of those boats is in danger of sinking. In Boston, one of my friends came up with the idea, you know, Back Bay is literally built on pilings, wooden pilings from the 1850s. And it's one of the reasons why there were so many problems when the Hancock building was being built. It just had been made, that messed up water table all over there, and a lot of the pilings started to rot, and that could have been an absolute disaster. So he was suggesting that we could have sensors on all of those pilings, and we'd be able to monitor them. As I was driving in tonight, I was hearing a healthcare story, and it made me remember about one of the cool IoT apps now, where there is a asthma inhaler with a GPS in it, and it transmits the user's location when they have to use the inhaler. And so you can actually identify asthma hotspots in a city. So it just is amazing, the potential that we can realize with this kind of thing if we actually start organizing and make it a reality. So, we need your help. We haven't reached critical mass. We've had multiple meetings in Cambridge and Boston over the last year or so. Haven't been able to do it. We're thinking that perhaps one strategy that would work would be through the academic institutions in Boston and Cambridge, and try to get them to do it so that it, for them, quite literally, an IoT laboratory, and maybe they can just bypass everybody else. And remember, in Amsterdam, it took them only 10. Now, we have a goal of actually, that deserves an asterisk by it, because they didn't really reach the neighborhoods. We'd like to do. And we think it's very important. You know, the guy from the Vineyard was talking about trying to reach some of those low-income residents. We want to reach Roxbury and Dorchester and Mattapan, not just downtown and, you know, Cambridge. Cambridgeport, places like that as well. And we quite literally are looking for friends in high places with GE relocating. There was news in the last week or so that Jeff Immelt is buying a $4.5 million condo in one of the high-rise towers. It may actually be the Millennium Place thing, since they really have transformed themselves into an IoT company. I'm thinking of reaching out to him and say, hey, Jeff, how about putting one in the window in your apartment? We shall see. Anyway, anybody who knows anybody in one of those high-rises, we need them. And we need volunteers to take responsibility. We're reassessing the whole thing now, but we do hope to get going again in the next couple weeks. We do have a Slack, and if you will contact me, if you're at all interested in taking part in this, I'm not the administrator of the Slack, but I can put you in touch with the guy who is, and you'll be able to join that. So this is so personally embarrassing to me, because it does seem to me it is an absolute no-brainer that Greater Boston is the fourth leading concentration of IoT companies in the world. And if we can't get something like this off the ground here, that's really pathetic. So that's where the shame element comes in. And
shoemaker's kids wear bare feet.
Exactly. So I hope that we are all sufficiently embarrassed to take part in this noble effort. And do contact me if you're interested in taking part. And we can use any and all volunteers on the thing. And again, I do hope that within the next two or three weeks we will regroup. We let it ride for a couple months because everybody was so dispirited. Yes?
What about security of some of these IoT devices?
I had this just secondhand from the people in Amsterdam, but they really have evidently designed in very, very strict standards for that. And that, you know, that's one of the reasons why our group has really taken the lead on privacy and security issues. I'm writing a book on IoT strategy right now, and I have in there four what I call essential truths of the IoT. They were share data rather than hoard it, close the loop so that you have feedback loops and data can feedback and regulate the processes, MDM and things like that, and then rethink the role of products, either literally redesign them or their role in the thing. And then the last one was you have to make privacy and security a priority from the beginning. And about 2 months ago, I rejiggered things, and privacy and security is now the number one thing. I can't emphasize it enough that particularly as we get into personal health data and things of that is intensely personal, that we cannot develop these devices without making privacy and security an absolute priority. So believe me, when it comes to this, we're going to make sure that is a critical part of whatever we do. Yes?
So how bad would it be if, to get started, you put a gateway in some place that's not the highest point on the Torrance board? Suppose you just, I mean, seriously, I don't know what the propagation limits are on this. Let's say you wanted to encourage some sort of IoT activity in Roxbury, for example.
Yeah.
So maybe you don't do it for all of you. And Roxbury is not small, so you do it for all of Roxbury.
Yep.
You choose a couple of blocks and you put it in somebody's window.
Yeah.
Whoever's a taker.
There's an innovation center now
Right, the city started.
In Roxbury. And that is one place we've reached out to. They're also one of the places that I think is particularly vulnerable. I've done a couple shows with Sanjay Sarma at GBH, and they've got Great Blue Hill. And so that one would be a perfect location to do that. So it's...
But you don't have to start...
No, you're right. It doesn't have to be. Yeah, and better to have something rather than nothing. And the great thing, and then of course, you can also, you could obviously reposition them as the network grows.
Sure.
So I think that's a great idea, yes.
I got a question about blockchain and Bitcoin.
Mm-hmm.
Chain of custody in energy systems is very important.
Yes.
That's the phrase that they're using in blockchain. And the idea here is that the investors need to be represented with a valid risk management strategy that goes right down to the individual house.
Yeah.
So my question is, are there people in the IoT community who are getting hooked up with blockchain or some other method
of
doing chain of custody of information in the
energy
world?
There are people working on that now.
Thank you.
Now, we would be working particularly with low data volumes. And so transactional things probably would not be in what we're doing.
This is slow speed stuff.
But that is definitely happening right now. It's a big topic of conversation. Yes.
You're talking about setting up all these radios that are operating at gigahertz frequencies.
Yeah.
Don't you need permission from the federal government?
No. No, you don't.
You do not.
Not with these.
It's a free band.
Oh.
As long as you broadcast under, what is it, like 2 watts or 1 watt? I can't remember.
Yeah.
So you can do whatever you want.
Yeah.
915 in particular.
Is it
ISM?
ISM. That's what it was. Yeah.
Yeah.
How does it work if two organizations want to use the same frequency in the same area?
That's why we're trying to do it collaboratively.
I see.
Yeah.
I see.
And
again, this is the real emphasis on this.
Well,
is non-commercial.
One or both of you is SOL.
It's not totally that, because the device is intelligent. It tries to not broadcast on top of something else.
But the regulations for the unregulated spectrum are you must suffer interference and not cause interference.
Yeah.
So I see.
You cooperate or die.
So it's like sailing on
the
trawl.
But this is also why you're going to run into brick walls trying to talk to the people that are renting out the high spaces, because they're working with professional engineers, with worried about human exposure to RF in the managed rooftop, and they do not want anything that can cause interference up there, and they don't want amateur people going out on the roof where it's a controlled environment, professional engineers only as a safety rule.
Gotcha. Yeah.
So it's not, it's not evil profit. It's safety regulation.
Yeah. No. And we are, and we're actually talking. Turns out, a lot of them in Amsterdam are in windows of apartments, and that's one of the ways they've been able to get around.
The gateway or the national nodes.
The gateways. Yeah. Yes?
There's a new contract that Verizon has with the city of Boston, and they are going to be putting radios on poles throughout the city. And here in Cambridge, I've just very recently started noticing these large, sometimes this big around, brown cylinders, maybe yo-high, with two very fat cables. They go down to a sort of a thick panel, looks like a breaker panel sized housing. It's on the pole, and the only thing else that goes into that, aside from these two fat cables, I don't know if it's a cable with all of the wires or one big fat coax, is power. just tap right onto the line, no meters, there's just a small fuse box or breaker panel underneath this thing.
Yeah.
And there's one near a low-income housing thing on the street that's one further from Mass Ave, parallel to Green, parallel to Mass.
Uh-huh.
It's a mega thing, it's a U-shaped building. And right across the street, this isn't on the pole directly, it's on a big metal arm out from the pole, so it's very obvious,
yeah,
the thing sitting there. And then there's another one on Windsor Street where the vertical brown cylinder is smaller diameter, but it's at the very top of the pole, but it has the same electronics thing down beneath it. And I suspect because of some friends' problems getting Comcast Wi-Fi in there, which is the Comcast signal, this thing's to do with Comcast because it messed up previous antenna arrangements. But I don't know that. And
yeah,
does anybody know about these?
So people are getting free Wi-Fi.
No fiber, no, nothing else going other than power and a radio box. So it's
going
to be some sort of a mesh thing.
Yeah.
So maybe it's just cheaper than running cable.
Probably is. Exactly. That's certainly where they're going.
There's numbers on it and a name, and I can't remember the name of the company, but I called them. And
uh-huh,
discovered it has been bought by somebody else, owned by somebody else, and they own most of the towers around the country, the major towers.
Oh, yeah, yeah.
And this is their act as contractors for other people, but they are, quote, experts. And they run
American
around.
American Tower, is that it, maybe?
Yeah, I think it's American Tower.
Yeah.
And they were a little bit cagey answering my questions, which may be a dumb receptionist or maybe a bright receptionist who knows what she's not supposed to say.
Exactly. Well, thank you all very much. And yes?
And one question on the other end of this spectrum.
Yes.
You were mentioning these powered garbage cans. Like, we have those in Brookline.
Yeah.
Like you said, there's
yep,
one for garbage and the other's for recycling.
Yeah.
And I always wondered about it because I saw the solar panel. But what happens when there's no sun? Does that mean that there's batteries in those things?
Yeah.
So you could theoretically, if you get people interested in Brookline, you could theoretically run your project.
Yeah. And the people at Big Belly, the company that does those, is very interested in this, so they see it as sort of complementary to their efforts. Yes, sir.
Can you quickly say who in Boston you've been talking to and how high up you've been able to go?
Well, the mayor's office knows all about it. They've been very cooperative with this, but we've been adamant from the beginning that we don't want it to be a city project, because like the mayor's office and New Urban Mechanics would be perfect partners in the whole thing, but we don't want it to be something that can be captured by, you know, the Walsh administration or anything like that. Not that they're bad guys or anything, but we think for its integrity it has to be independent.
So I got a guy up there.
I guess what?
Yes.
So what's the holdup? What's the issue?
It's just inertia. We have not been able to get people to plunk down $1,200 to buy the units and install them.
How much bandwidth could you get over something like that?
I don't know, frankly. It's changing. So, yes.
So I'm wondering if there are so many IoT companies in Boston, why there isn't already widespread coverage? Are they using different technology? Are they just not connecting to the network?
Yeah,
are they just vaporware? Like, why don't they have signals that other people can connect to?
Good question, but they don't.
What?
Yeah.
Okay.
Yes.
So it's not LoRaWAN, they're just using different.
The Wi-Fi, the new, you know, using lasers in a building. The desktop ones are only a few inches away, but some of the ones for ceilings are now what, 10 meters away?
Right.
Or thereabouts. But is that capable, if you have a long black tube and you have it aimed right and going across town? I live in Arlington. I live in a house on a hill. I can see a lot of Cambridge from my third floor windows. And there's lots of other people in Arlington that way. And then there's the old hospital on the hill on the other side where those people up there have phenomenal view of most of Cambridge.
Right.
And from one place there, if you had things which are highly directional, like light in a black tube and carefully aimed, you could do amazing things, I would think.
Yeah. These are not directional. That's one of the big advantages of them, so.
Yes? I have one question. What about Cygnet? I thought they have coverage over all of Boston.
They do. They have commercial, and we've talked with them. But again, we're trying to do this non-commercial. And, and they're very helpful, good people and everything, but we're trying to do it separate from all that, preserve the integrity. Thank you all very much.